worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior, totally transcended, expert in all dimensions, knower of all worlds, unsurpassable trainer of those who can be trained, both teacher and guides of gods as well as of humans, blessed, exalted, awakened, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Perfectly formulated is this Buddha Dhamma, visible right here and now, immediately effective, timeless, inviting each and everyone to come and see for themselves, inspect, examine, and verify, leading each and everyone through progress towards perfection, directly observable, experienceable, and realizable by each intelligence. Perfectly training is this noble Sangha community of the Buddha's noble disciples. They're training the right way, the true way, the good way, the direct way. Therefore, to these eight kind of individuals, these four noble pairs deserve both gifts, self-sacrifice, offerings, hospitality, and reverential salutation, the joint palms, since this noble Sangha community of the Buddha's noble disciples is an unsurpassable and indeed forever unsurpassed field of merit in this world, for this world, to honor, respect, support, uphold, and protect. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 87, approaching 100. I recorded on the 29th December 2017 on planet Earth, under the cypress tree, close to the Cypress Hermitage, on Knuckles Mountain, Seltran, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Welcome. There are three questions and one meditation course advertisement, and the normal intro comes right here. Namo. Tassa. Bhagavato. Arahato. Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. First, I'd like to make a small advertisement again for a meditation course I make here, close here by, in a very nice place called Candy Meditation Center or Candy Samadhi Center, the 17th to the 30th June next year, next summer. Everybody's welcome. It is, we have to pay for the room and board and so on, because it's a work size a hotel. There's people employed there. This is a little unfortunate, but I hope in the future will have access to a meditation center where one can come and receive this for free. But send me an email if you're interested. There's 20 positions, or can be 20 people participating, and there's 7 who have ordered so far. So there's 13 open positions. Also, remember another thing, click subscribe. And if you already have subscribed, click the small bell. This is your ticket to Nirvana, and clicking the small bell and the like button, this makes these videos being presented to others, so they have access to get a ticket to Nirvana by reordering their view and direction of life. Question 259. Can real love exist within the 4 Brahma Viharas, the 4 infinite and divine states? Yes, indeed it can. Indeed it can. I would go as far as say, as these 4 divine states are the real love. Usually what we say is love, knows also you say you fall in love with somebody. Usually this is a commercial enterprise where one exchange pleasure in the form of orgasm. I give you sex, you give me sex. The married variants. I give you sex, you give me money. I give you sex or money, you give me social security. So it's a swapping of things, and therefore it's a commercial enterprise. One can see that it's not love in the sense that as soon as this, if one part doesn't give the other part what is what should be giving in the swapping part, whether it's sex or money or social security or social status or company, then this love disappears from one moment to the next moment. It becomes often very, very fierce hate and aggression and complaints and so on. So since it can change just like that, if the other part doesn't deliver what should be swapped, whether sex or money or social position, well, then it cannot be real love in my opinion. Real love is not an exchange. In real love, there's not a when you give with one hand, then you expect to get something back with the other hand. In real love, you just love. It's a flow out of the heart. This flow out of the heart, this goodwill towards all beings, whoever they are, whatever they've done, wherever they are, however they look, whether high or low, here or there, whether somebody coming to being or somebody who is already coming to being, whether young or old, beautiful or ugly. This flowing out from the heart we call goodwill or metta, friendliness, after the root word metta, which means friend. So this goodwill, I think, is a real love, because this doesn't expect anything back. And therefore, this is not a commercial enterprise, swapping this and that. It's not. It's only something outflow of goodwill and kindness and gentleness and well-wishing for another being or a set of other beings. And this morning, as I did also in several other mornings, I did 2.5 hours of well-wishing for all beings. And I make several videos of it and also audios of it, and you can go and seek for it. And it gives an uplifting of mind, uplifting of mind. And this is surreal love. Second question, if yes, is there a way to lose that real love? Yes, one loses it whenever one becomes angry or irritated or goes into the opposite state of this goodwill, this friendliness, this loving kindness, goes into irritation or opposition, rejection, then it's lost. But it can be regained immediately by redirecting mind to this aspect of universal friendliness, cosmic goodness, which is not romantic at all. It's not an idealistic socialist hippie idea. It's a very pragmatic, skillful, divine, infinite state, neither more no less. One object I often use myself to induce this. You say, how can you induce this real love of metta, of universal friendliness? Yes, one basically the course is one redirects mind from the negative aspects of beings and the world and situations to the positive aspects of the same thing. And, all beings and situations and phenomena has both negative and positive aspects. Looking at the negative aspects, focusing on them, makes aversion arise. Looking at the other aspects can make goodwill arise. The ideal regarding other beings, the ideal fact to refocus mind on, in my opinion, is the fact that all conscious beings one day will be enlightened. They had what in Mahayana Buddhism is called the Tathagata Garbha, the Buddha nature embedded in their consciousness. Whether they will enlighten tomorrow or in 10,000 years or in 100,000 universal cycles, we don't know. But what we do know is that all of them, whether ant or a rich person or deva or devil or a fascist or one who tortures other beings or whoever, whatever, butcher, they all have this aspect that one day they will be enlightened because they have this light within their consciousness, embedded in their consciousness, this possibility of one day enlightening. And this is, thinking about this very, very positive aspect, I think the most positive aspect of all beings. This is then easy to make goodwill arise and to try to talk to this aspect. I talk to this aspect of your ability to one day be enlightened and feeding that, trying to make it grow right now. And so can you with all other beings. So real love do exist, has nothing to do with sex, has nothing to do with swapping of commercial entities such as sex, money, social position, social security, housing, cars, whatever can be swapped. Has nothing to do with swapping. It is something very genuine flow out from the heart. It's very, very skillful. And which the Brahma Devas, we are in the Kamaloka, the lower 11 levels, we are level 5 from 12 and upwards to 22. Brahma Devas, they reside always in this state. They live this 150 billion years without even one single moment of irritation, opposition, rejection. So this is a really refined, high, and I think by many unrecognized state, how subtle and how powerful it really is, this goodwill, this metta, this loving kindness, this friendliness, this friendship with everyone, this all-embracing goodwill, kindness. And of course, then harmlessness comes easy. It's inherently embedded in this goodwill. Huh? You don't want to harm those you love, basically. So that's a real love, I think. This is this friendliness. And this you can have, it's not gender specific, has nothing to do with sex. So you can have it towards your dog, the cats, the birds here, the eagle that are agreeing in what is said. Those on the other side of the planet, those of other planets in other galaxies, whatever beings it may be, you can have this goodwill towards. So it's an attitude, it's a stance one takes. And one can live with this in this stance, this attitude. This is called Brahma Vihara. One lives in it like in a house, lives in this, continually in this attitude. Well, then some irritation object comes up, can be politics or people are doing something evil, raping each other or whatever. Then there's a moment of irritation and opposition and rejection, basically derivatives of hate. Then it's lost, but then it can be regained again by thinking about it. Ah, now there's aversion in my mind. So I can come back to this goodwill, this friendliness, this all-embracing thing that is very big and warm and open and glowing and beaming and skillful and extremely advantageous. It's the antidote against hate, which is one of the three main defilements. Greed, hate, ignorance. Huh? If this greed, hate, ignorance goes away, well, then enlightenment occurs. And this is a tool to make greed, make hate go away. I hope this answers this question. Question 260. Please tell about your own path toward renunciation and ordination. Yes. I was a doctor in my late 30s, and I had a son, and he was, I think, around 3 or 4 years old, and a wife in a very nice house in a very nice suburb to Copenhagen, where there was a small lake and so on. So it was in fairly good situations. The research team I was a member of, I was associate professor in bioinformatics at the Technical University in Denmark at that time. And we just got 14 billion Danish kroner to make research, so we can travel around the world and so on. Nevertheless, because of restrictions, you can say, and also expectations in this situation, then, for example, regarding my professional life, both doing the clinical work with other doctors and doing research in a research group, it always puzzled me and made me very sad that what seems to be possible for the patient, the correct treatment for the patient, and the correct way of doing the research, that was never really, perfection was never really achieved there, because it was a compromise between inside this group of doctors or inside this group of researchers that took these decisions. So it was always less than ideal. And when I looked at it, why was it less than ideal? Then I came to realize that it was not something lack of money or lack of funds or lack of medicine or lack of knowledge. It was simply because of mental defilement in this group that you should take these decisions about the research, about the patients. And this goes for any workplace and any group of people that's taking decisions. It's the mental defilements that set the restriction, how high they can go, how good they can do it. So if there's aversion in the mind, if there's greed in the mind, if people are against each other because they are in a competition, if there is a greed because they want to have a higher position in this group, higher job, or get the Nobel Prize, or become rich, if there's doubt and uncertainty, if there's somebody of this is lazy, they don't want to do their job, and if somebody is restlessness and have a lot of worries, then of course in this group cannot be taken ideal decisions leading to the goal of this particular work situation. And this frustrated me very much because I invested a lot of effort in it. And you can say the same thing in the private life, whether you can become happy with a partner and within your family life with children and so on, is also restricted by the mental defilements, both of oneself and the other ones. So the problem of disharmony of problematic private life or professional life, one seems often to point it out, is the others who are wrong in this conflict situation or whatever problematic circumstance there is. Not seeing that there's some mental defilements that is wrong, both in oneself and the others. And it's this mental defilements that ruins the show, because this mind initiates all, begins all, sets all going, shapes everything. So all phenomena are determined by this mind, whether one's own mind, internal mind, or external mind. And if this mind is defiled, well, then this ruins the show. My own reaction before I realized that was to say, okay, there's problems with this set of colleagues. I get a new job and get a new set of colleagues. I can get a new wife and a new family and so on. However, it quickly appeared to me that that it was not that problem, actually, because the same issues of these mental defilements was found in whatever group I searched for, whatever wife or life partner I searched for. It's the same thing happened. That this collective set of mental defilements, they ruined the show. So there was external circumstances, the funds, the money, the cars, and so on. The job, the social position, for being happy, but nevertheless I was not happy, because I think the results that was achieved by this, I took my life as a doctor very serious, this was less than far than ideal. People basically died. I saw people died because of mistakes making collectively in this group. So this made me very, very frustrated. So eventually, after having searched several groups and several jobs and several partners and several situations, then I say, happiness is not to be found here. And then I start meditating, and then eventually also studying. One day I met the text of the Buddha on the internet, and then I immediately said, here is it. So I think it was an event of recognition. So I studied the same thing many, 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 many times before, but could not remember it actively. But there was a remote remembrance. So when I was presented with these texts of the Gautama Buddha on the internet, then immediately I could recognize, and thereby remember this freedom and peace and equanimity that results from studying these texts and acting them out. And then I decide, after some years after I have become a Buddhist, I decide to ordain. And then I ask my family and my son and so on. So he said to me, he was four at that time, said, yeah, I could ordain and go out from my home when he was seven. And this, my grandma also died, so, and I could put my economy in order and so on. And so eventually I took a meditation course in year 2000 in Thailand. And next year I came here, and then next year again become ordained. So this was basically it. It was a gradual process. How, when you look in the text, everybody else that go ordains that has been monks before, they also kind of like struggles with their private life or family life. Why is it so? I think it's because one has remembrance about this noble life in the forest and the freedom of it and the lightness of it and the profundity of it. And when one has tried this before, many lives usually, then whatever private life, whatever professional life one has, it looks pale, it looks full of conflicts, it looks dirty, it looks very, very problematic and painful, painful, painful. Day after day, monotony, you have to go and experience these circumstances that are far, far, far from perfect. Not even excellent, not even good in many situations. So those who have tried the noble life before, they are plagued continuously by this complete absurdity, meaninglessness, with this going on work, earning money, going to the supermarket and eating food and then cleaning and doing the same the next day again and again and again, then going to vacation, waiting for the weekend and so on. That doesn't seem to be any meaning, and it's true, there is no meaning in feeding this body and mind pleasure. And that's basically the purpose of having a job. It is earning money so you can have a nice apartment, a house, family, and so you can go on vacation and eat good food and have entertainment. But this doesn't make sense on the long run. It's a perpetual process because you have to refeed the body and re-entertain the body and take it out to bed every day and brush teeth on it. So it's a never-ending story. It's a never-ending story. And this pit of craving becomes deeper and deeper and deeper the more pleasure you feed this hypothetical ego. So it doesn't make sense. So it is absurd. It is suffering. It is meaningless. And seeing this to the full extent then makes one relinquish it. And this one can relinquish it, let it go, not identifying it as happiness. Though one has tried to make it happy, one tries to bend the world and bend one's circumstances, private life and professional life, so it becomes happy. But as soon as one stops bending, bling, it goes back into some very frustrating state. So eventually when one gives up that, then one can relinquish it, let it go. It's a gradual process, it doesn't happen just in once. It happens by one having more and more frustration coming from in one's professional life or private life, and then realizing, but it's true, there is some suffering there. It is not only happiness. It is not only a romantic story, like they say. Like my parents said, huh? If you get a job, university job, then you become happy. If you become rich, then you become happy. If you become famous, then you become happy. If you have a beautiful spouse and thereby high quality sex, then you become happy. No, that's not the case. Usually, rich, famous people can have many mental problems. Many of them will have to have a psychiatrist, a psychologist, and a coach, and so on, in order to get along life in a non-traumatic way. So money and fame and high-level pleasure, luxury, is not causing happiness. It's causing addiction, and addiction is binding. So it's a form of unfreedom, lack of freedom, imprisonment. So I was asked yesterday by a Indian that was here and visited me whether I ever have regretted going forth into the noble life, and that's not the case. These 16 years I have spent, or 17 now, 16 and a half year I have spent as a monk, I never even one single moment regretted that I took this decision. It's the best decision I ever have taken. Best decision. But it was not easy. By no means. It is difficult to go forth. Difficult. Because you have to give up basically the entire world. And that's not easy when you have been habitually addicted to it, like a ring in your nose, for billions of lives. But it's the only way out of this imprisonment of body and mind and the world. So, I'm very happy I did it. I'm very happy I did it. I can recommend it to anyone who thinks, but one can also make progress as a lay Buddhist. And I think also I did for a long time as a lay Buddhist. 4 or 5 years I trained as a lay Buddhist before I eventually decided to go forth. But one doesn't need to go forth. One can also make significant progress as a lay person. However, one is restricted by lack of time, because one has a family and a job and so on, lack of time to train 100%, 24/7. One cannot train as actively because one is overwhelmed and flooded in by these practical problems of going to work and feeding the family and maintaining a house and so on. Being a householder, basically. Huh? So full-time professional training gives more upward curves, but lay life gives a slower curve. It's just a matter of speed, but the goal is the same. Question 261. How do we show disgust towards the five khandhas without also developing aversion? Yeah, first, what is the five khandhas? It's the five clusters of clinging. It's also, some say, it's the five aggregates, the five groups of form, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness. This is the five khandhas. This is an all-inclusive classification. So this is internal form. Other bodies are external form. This tree is external form. This mountain is external form. Internal feeling of pleasure, pain, sadness, gladness, neutral feeling. External feeling in others of the same. Mental construction, perception, basically experience, visual perception, auditory, something hearing, olfactory, smelling, gustatory perception, tasting, tactile perception, touching, and mental perception, thinking, or experiencing mental states like drugged, for example. Mental construction, basically hoping, intending, after having seen something, then intending something caused by this visual contact, and after having touched, intending something after this tactile contact, after having thought something, considered something, then intending after having this mental contact with a given object, a dream, a hope. This is mental construction. Consciousness, six kinds again. Visual consciousness, auditory consciousness, olfactory consciousness, gustatory consciousness, tactile consciousness, and mental consciousness. These five clusters we cling to, these five groups we cling to. Huh? the Buddha, he how not to cause aversion to it. If one understands that they are suffering, ultimately speaking, and they are not me, not mine, not what I am, not what I am made of, never was, never will be, then one can relinquish them. So it's not a matter of aversion, it's a matter of disillusion after having seen this discussed. When you have an illusion about something, then these five clusters of clinging, form, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness, they appear as happiness. Huh? The young girl who looks herself in the mirror and see how beautiful it is, how happy that is. Same thing with feeling, perception, when you eat something, nice food, soft ice, whatever. Mental consciousness, when you smoke marijuana or take an alcoholic drink. Happiness. Yes, but also suffering. Why is this suffering? Because it's impermanent. It's not lasting. It cannot be lasting. That's why it's suffering, because when you lose it again, lose this pleasure that is kind of like have an up and then a down. On the downside, you always feel frustration. And now the pleasure is going down, then you take one more spoon of soft ice, have one more event of sex, or take one more drink or one more joint, and so forth. Go one more year on work together with colleagues that are very painful to have conflict. For example, one's boss. Then I'm very happy to say, as a monk, one doesn't have a boss. There can be senior monks, but there's no boss. There's no boss. You are responsible for yourself. And that's a very free way of living. Also one has to be very responsible to this noble life. But it's a relief not to have a boss, not what you have, or some circumstances that tells you what to do, that determines what you should do today or tomorrow, blah, blah, blah. You should do like this and that, this and that, and this and that. However irrational that is, however stupid, meaningless, absurd that is, as long as one is addicted to sense pleasure and to these five clusters of clinging, then one do this, whatever that is, one's boss or what this life circumstances tells one to do. So it's a swapping, huh? You want pleasure, then you take the pain of going to work, for example, or staying in a family, or staying in a particular social group, where they're always there in all families, in all job situations. Among all people, all beings, there is always problems. Always problems. It cannot be escaped. I would say even the only exception I know of is a number of arahats, awakened beings. There will be, among them will be no problems. And also they will talk very little. They will not say much to each other. If they sit silently and feel a very deep, subtle cessation of the five clusters of clinging called Nirodha Samabhatti. So one should not be naive with this. Nevertheless, form, the Buddha said, this is kind of like a lump of foam, of froth, this form and that form. It looks substantial, but even if you look at it at an atomic scale or in quantum mechanics as a bubble of probability, a cloud of probability. So it looks substantial, but if you look at it closer, then it has no substance. It's like a lump of foam. Feeling is like a bubble, plop, it goes away. Perception is like a mirage, a fatamorgana. It looks in the outside the horizon, outside the body, at the end of consciousness, that it looks real. But when you come closer, then it's not real. It's an illusion. Mental construction like a plantain, a banana tree, that is, or like an onion, there's no core. If you peel up the layers inside, there's nothing. There's nothing. Consciousness like a magician's trick, an illusion, a 3D computer game illusion like thing. So it looks like something substantial out there, independent of the consciousness that perceives it. But if there's no consciousness perceiving it out there, there's only probabilities, potentialities for particles to be in certain locations and have certain properties. So also from a physical point of view, if there's no consciousness, then there's no world. He also likened the five clusters of flame to five killers. They are going around right after you with a sword up, and as soon as you show unmindfulness, chop the chop off your head. So it's five serial killers that has killed us so many times that it cannot be calculated on a calculator, even with exponential notation. So many times has this clinging to form, clinging to feeling, clinging to perception, clinging to mental construction, and clinging to consciousness. So many times has it killed us. What is it you want? You want to continue to be killed by these five clusters of clinging, or what? Is that happiness, to be killed repetitively? I don't think so. How does one see? One sees it like this. This does not belong to me. This I am not. This is not my ego. This is like the bubbles of Ganges. It's unsubstantial, unreal. This internal form is not me, not mine, not what I am. Doesn't belong to me. This feeling, these experiences, these memories, these hopes, these dreams, this consciousness of being aware of this and that, visual forms and color, auditory sounds, meaning that comes out of the YouTube channel. This is not me, not mine, not what I am. Doesn't belong to me or anybody else. It is transient, it is passing, and therefore is suffering if one clings to it. If one doesn't cling to it, then it's not suffering. So the five clusters of clinging, it is not the object that is clung to that is suffering. It is the clinging itself that causes suffering. Why so? Because clinging is a solidified, cementified, intensified form of craving. And craving is the cause of suffering. And these five clusters of clinging is suffering. In short, huh? The Buddha say, what is this first noble truth of suffering? It's the obvious suffering of pain of the body and pain of the mind. But in short, it is these five clusters of clinging. It's a mental imprisonment in the sense that, he said, it's like a dog tied to a post. It cannot come around. It has to go around because it's leashed. It has a leash to this post. So it cannot go away from the post. And same thing with these conscious beings that travel through samsara. They keep coming back to these five clusters of clinging because they cling to it. Even in the rebirth moment, they cling to some world, some form, some perception. And if they have the karma to it, then they are immediately projected onto such a form, such a world, such a situation that they cling to, that they want, that they see as happiness. And therefore, life after life, they keep coming back to this same post, just like a dog tied to a post with a leash around its neck. Is that freedom? Obviously not. Is it permanent? Amongst once asked, is there anything in this world among these five clusters of clinging that is permanent, that then one can trust as a source of happiness? Then the Buddha, he took up with his little fingernail a small amount of soil, and he said, if there is anything in this cosmos, in this universe, in this world that is permanent, as much as this one's dust that is on the tip of my fingernail, then this noble life was not necessary. Then you could post your happiness on that particular permanent object. But since there is not anything in this world, internally, externally, past, present, or future, high or low, inferior or superior, beautiful or ugly, that is permanent, then this noble life is necessary, is required in order to reach happiness. Because there's nothing out there or in there, past, present, or future, that can be trusted because it's permanent, lasting, stable. Nothing. So You also said it's a, like a house on fire. You, it keeps burning, it keeps burning. What is it burning with? It's burning with greed, with hate, with ignorance, with rebirth, with aging, with decay, with sickness, pain, with death. I tell you, these five clusters of clinging are burning with suffering, he said. With suffering and nothing else than that. So it's an acquisition of fuel. When you take upon you, take up upadana, basically mean uptake, take up, like one who passed through and sees something lying on the street, and then you take it up. Taking up this form, taking up this feeling, taking up this perception, taking up this mental construction, taking up this consciousness, welcoming it, taking delight in it, saying it's not only okay, I want it, I want more of it. This is acquisition of fuel. And this fuel will then burn. And this fuel burns with suffering, aging, sickness, and death. Some texts, let's see, do we have time? Ah, yes, we have plenty of time. This material body is like a prison because it's a site of punishment. Perception is like an offense because its weird contact causes the punishment. Feeling is like the punishment. One cannot control as is caused by contact. Mental construction is like the punisher, since his fear craving causes feeling. Consciousness is like the villain, because that is what is tormented by the feeling. It's from Visiddhimagga. Cut short, not being disgusted with the five, and thereby disillusioned by the five clusters of clinging, is caused by right view. And what is right view regarding the five clusters of clinging? What is the correct right comprehension, seeing the five clusters of clinging, this form, this feeling, this perception, this mental construction, and this consciousness? One sees them collectively as something that is impermanent, as painful, as a disease, as a boil, as a dart, a calamity, an affliction, as alien, as remote, as disintegrating, as a plague, as a terror, as a menace, as a disaster, as fickle, as perishable, as not lasting. One sees these five clusters as clinging, as transient, as no protection, as no shelter, as no refuge, as empty, as vain, as void, as no self. One sees them as danger, as subject to change, as having no core, as the root of ruination. One sees these five clusters of clinging as murderous, as due to be annihilated, as subject to fermentation, as constructed of parts, as Mara's bait, as subject to birth, subject to aging, subject to illness, subject to death, subject to sorrow, subject to lamentation, subject to despair, subject to defilement. By seeing that the five clusters of clinging are impermanent, one thus acquires a fondness, an inclination, a preference with what conforms to the Dhamma. So one turns away one's maniac addiction with these five clusters of clinging to the Dhamma that leads out of this imprisonment in the five clusters of clinging, that releases from this addiction of these five clusters of clinging. By seeing that ceasing of these five clusters of clinging is a very immutable Nibbana, one enters into the certainty of rightness, and this is therefore perfectly right view. Paticca-samuppada and Visuddhimagga both have these citations. Stilling of all clinging ceases all suffering. Stilling, silencing, ending, stopping all clinging ends all suffering. No clinging, no panic. No panic, no fear. No fear, no suffering. The fading away, silencing, stilling, ceasing and bringing to an end of all feeling, of all perception, of all mental construction, and of all consciousness. Only this pacification completely eliminates all suffering, ends all disease, and fully overcomes all decaying, sickness, all aging, and all death. Samyutta Nikaya 22:30. So, only the ending of all form, all body, and all physical world is the freedom from all imprisonment. Only the ending of all feeling is the freedom from all physical pain. Only the ending of all perception is the freedom from all disturbance, all agitation, all noise. Only the ending of all mental construction is freedom from all stress. Only the ending of all consciousness is the freedom from all suffering. So how does it work? So the Noble Disciple, he's first disgusted with these five clusters of clinging, because now he or she can see them as suffering, as addictive, as murderers. Then he's disgusted with it. This disgust doesn't lead to aversion, to hate, but it frees from having been very addicted. One goes to the middle of the road, not to the other side, where one starts to hate or being aversive. But in the middle of the road, there's this neutral feeling where one is disillusioned. It's not only a form of disappointment. It is further more than that. It's a form where one stops having an illusion. And this is disillusion. One comes to see these five clusters of clinging, whether internal or external, whether past, present or future, as suffering, and therefore one stops clinging to them. When one stops clinging to them, this is release. So this release is because caused by this disenchantment. When one doesn't see them, one is not enchanted by them, by illusory fondness or promissory happiness. Maybe I'm not happy now. Maybe these five clusters of clinging, they doesn't need to give me happiness now, but they will in the future. This promissory happiness, huh? So this causes tenacious clinging, even though there is suffering obviously here, everywhere, every day. One has pain in the body and feels sadness, frustration in the mind for momentary or for long time. Then one still thinks, because of this tenacious clinging, that these five clusters of clinging are happiness. And as long as one sees that them as happiness, then one wants them, one craves them. As soon as one craves them, and as long as one craves them, one clings to them. And this clinging is suffering. Neither more nor less. Whatever, bhikkhus and friends, is this first noble truth of suffering. These five clusters of clinging are suffering. The cluster of clinging to material forms, rupa, is suffering. The cluster of clinging to mental feelings, vedana, is suffering. The cluster of clinging to mental perceptions, sanya, is suffering. The cluster of clinging to mental constructions, sankara, is suffering. The cluster of clinging to the various kinds of consciousness, vijnana, is also suffering. This is rarely the first noble truth of suffering, said the Buddha. Any kind of form whatsoever, any kind of feeling whatsoever, any kind of perception whatsoever, any kind of construction whatsoever, any kind of consciousness whatsoever, whether past, present or future, whether internal or external, whether fair or foul, whether high or low, whether far or near, should be seen and understood as it really is. This is transient, impermanent, uncertain and ultimately unsafe. This is therefore disappointing, frustrating, and inevitably painful. This is us, not me, not mine, not what I am, not myself. Not myself. Seeing this, the noble learner is disgusted by all kinds of forms, feelings, perceptions, mental constructions, and all types of consciousness. Being disgusted, he experiences disillusion, disenchantment, and dispassion. By this very disillusion is craving fully extinguished, like a fire that goes out. And his mind is released. Such cooled and liberated one understands, right there on the spot, this round of rebirth is ended. This noble life is completed. Done is what should be done. Game over. Mission complete. There's no state of becoming beyond this. So the cluster of clinging to form internally is to one's own body and externally to what is appearing as my physical world and the bodies of others. The cluster of clinging to feeling is the obsession with pleasant feeling and fear of painful feeling and obstinate indifference towards neutral feeling. The cluster of clinging to perception is the monomaniac obsession with the diverse and momentarily tantalizing manifold objects of the six senses, all the experiences. The cluster of clinging to mental construction is the persistent passion for intending, planning, attending, thinking, involving, hoping, wanting, willing, and worrying. The cluster of clinging to consciousness is the addiction to all what is seen, heard, smelled, tasted, touched, cognized as ideas and mental states. A cluster of clinging means an assemblage, a bunch, a clump, a collection, a group, a knot of tightly adhering collection of various forms of attachment. Something that sticks together. This is a cluster of clinging. It sticks together. If you like this kind of sensation, you'll also like that kind of sensation. So it's a mental craving that sticks together. There's nothing here outside or apart from these clusters of clinging, neither internally nor externally. This fivefold classification is therefore complete. It covers everything, absolutely everything, since it covers all worldly phenomena. The cause of clinging is craving. The effect of clinging is becoming. The effect of becoming is rebirth, aging, decay, sickness, re-death, and thus suffering. Dig that or die. Again, dig that or die. Again, dig that or die, friends. So is it. Buddha said, friends, whoever recluse or priest now, in the past, or in the future regards whatever is pleasant and or attractive, that is in the world as permanent, as lasting, as happiness, as self, as healthy, as secure, only stimulates craving. By stimulating craving, they long for, thirst after, and hanker after, thereby inducing productions of sense desire, production of defilement, production of intentions, hopes, wishes, plans, and production of the five clusters of clinging. Because it sees the world as permanent. By nurturing uptake of such accumulation of fuel for becoming and fuel for existence, fuel, they indeed provoke continuation. Thus provoking prolongation, they are neither freed from birth, nor are they freed from decay or aging, nor are they freed from death. They are therefore not released from sorrow, from depression, from despair, from misery, from pain, from frustration, from discontent, nor from hopelessness. I tell you, they are not freed neither in the present nor from any future form of suffering. But friends, whoever recluse or priest now, in the past or in the future, regards whatever is pleasant and attractive in this world as impermanent, as transient, as suffering, as no self, as a disease, as danger, as fearful, as an empty terror. They thereby reduce all craving. After having gradually eliminated all craving, I tell you, they are freed from all suffering. He also said, recluses and monks who knows the cause of, the stilling of, and the way leading to the ceasing of these five clusters of clinging, who are training for the disgust towards these five clusters of clinging, for their fading away, for their dissolution, they are practicing well. They are later released and well liberated through this very non-clinging. Those who are well liberated are consummate nuns, completed ones. There's no way of describing such utterly perfected ones. From the Kanda Samyutta, here you see Samyutta Nikaya. There's a whole chapter, the chapter 22 is about these five clusters of clinging. And the Visuddhimagga, you see here, is a whole chapter 14 devoted to these five clusters of clinging. So they are a central core concept one has to understand. Therefore, I have produced 19 summarizes of these text or books. I'll give the link below on these five clusters of clinging on whatbuddhasaid.net. And the first one is in drops called Any Kind. Any Kind. So I recommend those who are seriously walking along this Noble Eightfold Way to study these 19 Dhamma drops on the five clusters of clinging. And I'll give the links below this video. So much for the words and the words today, 54 minutes. Thanks for your advantageous attention, clever consideration and kind contribution. Thanks to all the Dayakas, supporters and donors, especially those who gave food last time and recently, those who give the regular donations for the running costs and those who support the meditation hall. Again, remember to click subscribe and the small bell, and remember also to consider whether you want to participate in this meditation course in the two last weeks of June 2018. Thank you for your attention. Namo Tassu Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. No clinging, no suffering. Thank you and have a nice day.
You heard Bhikkhu Sammahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution and have a nice day.